We want to get rid of two really major devastating conditions. One is the condition in lung that actually kills you rather fast, and the second one is a tumor-related loss of immunity. You may wonder why we have these two projects, because they are so kind of a distant on the title pages, but that's not really the case. In the first item, we actually have learned to control the escalation of the inflammation, and we are really good in that. And in the second one, we are learned to remove the immune suppression. So they both are dealing with the endothelial cell surface receptors who actually operate at the level of inflammation. And as an end result, you actually could have this condition in different organs, depending where these molecules are active. So we are a public company, therefore the statement. And as Annette introduced, we just raised 8 million, but prior to that, we raised 10 million sterling last November when we IPO'd here in London. On that same year, we had a pre-IPO round for 5 million. So during the last 18 months or so, we have raised up to 30 million euros from the market. All of this is really meant to advance the pipeline. So the lead product is a traumakine. It's the name of the project. And like I said earlier, we would like to get rid of this condition that kills you, and it's an acute injury of the lungs. It's often called ARDS, which is the nickname of that and comes from the acute respiratory disease syndrome. We all can get it just by having a bus accident on the street or get a pneumonia or then a sepsis. I come later on to that one. It's now in the pivotal trial here in Europe called INTEREST trial. It's a 300 patient trial, and we are aiming a 50% reduction in the mortality. That's the hard endpoint of the trial. It's like a Western movie. You just count the lives and the deaths. It's very simple, but it's a complex condition, so it could be hard. We have an orphan indication in Europe for that one. We also have an EU funding for the project up to 6 million, which is really good for it, and it shows up in our H1 results, which we'll come to in a minute. And we already have done initial pharma deals in Far Asia, but we still have all the rights in Europe and US and rest of the globe. And of course, those are partially also commercial verification of the projects, because they have brought in money to the company, revenues, and also we have a very substantial profit-making possibility out of those deals once the product comes to the market. But that's not the only product, so we are not single product, even we have that in the phase 3. The clevisin has a tremendous potential alone or in combination of other immune therapies, and I will hope to be able to open that one as much as I can. We are looking now at the numbers of the H1 result. So we had revenues almost up to 2 million, partially from the licensing signing fee from the Korean deal, but also the grant income from this 6 million grant. So it meant that we only burned 2.6 million on this first half, even if we have a pivotal trial ongoing. It just shows how important the soft money funding also in this area is. And at the end of the period, we have 8.4 million cash, and then we now raised 8.5 million, so we are up to 15 plus million at the moment, and well covered for the end of the 17 and even further. Remember also that we are still rather a lean organization. We employ only 11 people, including myself. So most of the investments are project basis. So the fixed costs are really low, allowing us really to be flexible also in the future when we advance with the projects. This is the pipeline. So the ARDS is the main indication, that being now in the pivotal trial. However, we want to expand this also to other ischemic condition. And one severe one is that when you have a rupture in your aorta, if you are not operated immediately, you will die. But if you are operated and you survive, you have had an ischemic condition that normally will destroy your kidneys, livers, and so on. And the same treatment we have for the ARDS should be effective also in this condition. We have just filed CTA in Finland for this condition and initiate the trial on the first quarter next year. This is an opportunity of maybe 20,000 annual people, both in US and Europe. So it's a significant group of people as well. The ARDS, we are talking about 100,000 people globally. So it's much larger indication than that. The third one probably will be pancreatitis. We have not put it in there, but the data is very convincing that we actually could help also the patients with the pancreatitis. So that's trauma kind. Then we have this Clevergen, and we are building up a dossier which we hope to be able to expand into various indications where our target molecule Clever-1 is evidently having an impact on the cancer development, and those will be our target groups. That process is now dependent a little bit on the access of the GMP-produced antibody, and happy to say that Upsena is doing their best really to produce that for us. We made a deal just in July this year. And the last one, the yellow one, is just a diagnostic tool we want to apply for a ARDS to look at the severity of the condition and also how the treatment goes on at the patient level. So that's practically what we have. We have very intense a management group and a very supportive board. I'm not going to show the board names, but you can see in the printout that they are very sophisticated and experienced board members who are helping us. And also happy to show that we were just elected to be the management team of the year 16 and hopefully do well at the end of the November when the election will take place. But that was really nice surprise for us, of course. Talking about Traumakine, that's really the project name. And we really want to get rid of this condition, which you can see in here. This is a syndrome which eventually fills your lungs. It's your own fluid, it's your own cells, and they want to have a meeting in your lungs, and what happens, you lose your respiration capacity. This is an acute condition, so within the first 24 hours, you just lose your capacity. And what they do for you, they put you into mechanical ventilation, and then they try to manage your fluid. They want to keep you as dry as possible so that there wouldn't be further leakage into the lungs. There is no single pharmacological treatment for this condition up to now. And it is pretty amazing when we are thinking how important organs we are dealing with here. So what we do, we prevent this leakage. So we want to get rid of this to get back a normal lung. That's what we do with this treatment. And it is an ICU treatment, and we have roughly almost 300 patients in US and Europe all together at the moment. So even if it's an orphan, it's a very significant patient group. And they are very expensive. ICU could consume up to 25% of the hospital cost, so they are the most expensive units. So if you could do anything to get the patients out from the ICU, you benefit the hospital as well. So definitely a significant unmet medical need. We did a study here in UK where we tested the compound, which by the way is an interferon beta, which you heard earlier today. So it's again a reuse of a known compound, so it should be safe. So we tested this in a trial. We had 8 sites here in the UK. We had 38 test patients and 59 control patients, so roughly 100 patient trial. And you can see this dramatic difference in the mortality. This is our treatment group, and this is the normal non-treated group which were involved in this trial. So we had roughly 80% reduction in the odds of the mortality while we are giving the drug to these patients. Think about it, 80%. In our trial now, which is ongoing, we are only targeting 50% reduction. This is now published in the Lancet 2014. And not only we observe this reduction in the mortality, we also observe that we need less stay on the ICU. We also need less hemodialysis, meaning that the kidneys are doing better. And the recoveries were really fast with the treated patients. So the patients came back to the society and normal life much faster than normally. It means that this, if really could demonstrate now in the phase 3 trial, it really will have an impact on the treatment protocols on these patients in the future. And as I said, we already have now demonstrated that we can also make commercial deals. We started that very early in Japan and then move on to other continents, other countries. And these are the Japanese and the Korean deals are profit-making deals. We have 1/3 of the profits to us and 2/3 to them. In China, we went with the transfer price because it's more complex condition. And if they get good price, we get additional royalty out of it. So these have been really a significant deals, but like I said earlier, we still hold all the rights in Europe and US And those are the main targets for us also in the future. So Pan-European interest trial ongoing. We hope to finish the recruitment on the second half of the first half of the 17 and get the results on the second half. And if those are compelling, we hope to be able to file the conditional approval in Europe. And if that takes place, we would be in the market in 2018. So not that far away from here. Our Japanese partner made an independent study in their population, got very comparable results what we saw in our UK trial previously, and now they are planning their phase 3 trial in Japan. We have also filed additional patents to protect this compound maximally, because it's a new use of the compound. So we want to have a protection by the IP filings, but also through the orphan filings. And that we have now in Europe, we try to get a similar in US. And then also initially move on now with the new funds the company has also to initiate the activities on the US side. So this is now roughly the commercial road we plan to do. This is ongoing. Having compelling results, we go and interview or report to the EMA if it's possible to file the conditional filing. That would take us to the market. They probably will make us to make some follow-on safety study in Europe. But with this material, the Japanese partner hope to go to the market, combining our results with their phase 3 trial. And then FDA wants us to do a small safety study, and we plan to do that now, maybe the first half of the 17. And then having interest trial in Europe and phase 2 trial carried out in US, we go back to FDA and ask what else they want to do. If it happens that we will have a 50% reduction in the mortality, I don't think so we need to do any placebo-controlled trials anymore, because it would come completely unethical to put anybody on the placebo group. But of course, that remains to be seen. But it's a very exciting time for us, because within the next 18 to 24 months, we actually should have all this done and very close to the market. But then the Clevergen. Like I said, there are a lot of hope that we can actually utilize our own immune system to fight against the cancer. That is now mainly focusing on activation of our T-cell system, so that we actually could have cells that could actually recognize the cancer cells and then try to remove them. There's, however, another element in us that actually could prevent even that, and that is an active immune suppression. You have to have a balance between the activation and the suppression or inhibition, otherwise we wouldn't be here. And there are some cell types can do that, and of course the regulatory T cells are rather well known, but so are the type 2 macrophages. And especially these type 2 macrophages want to go around the tumor cells, they are attracted to go there, and they build this immune suppressive shield so that the cancer cells can actually hide the host immune system. They are very clever in doing this. And what we think that this an existing system in us normally, and we have learned that, for example, during the pregnancy, placenta that separates the embryo from the mother, these same cells are used to build the immune suppressive elements in the placenta so that the embryo can actually grow and survive in the mother's environment. Some pathogens utilize the same system when they want to build chronic infections. So this is an existing system. Cancer cells now have adapted this to their own benefit. And we have split this into several technologies. But in the cancer, it means that whatever you do on this side of the T-cell activation, and you recognize quite a number of these active partners here, PD-1 inhibitor sales, and also technology companies here in Europe and US, that's just fine, and I would do the same, but at the same time, I would remove the shield around the tumor. And in order to do that, you have to knock out these TAM2 macrophages. And we do this one single antibody, which is now under a CMP production, and as soon as we have material, we may do some primate tox study, but that's even questionable, and we want to move to the early phase clinical studies as soon as possible. Maybe 12 months from here, I hope. So, very well patented, soft money funding, and now GMP manufacturing ongoing. So it's progressing as planned at the moment. So what this in practice means? we want to knock out these immune suppressive type 2 macrophages and convert them into a type 1 macrophages. And when we do this, we remove the immune suppressive environment and generate immune activation. So this would actually be like you reactivate your own immune system locally at that site where the tumor is growing. And this we can do with one single antibody dosing. We have quite a number of animal models already tested and it's functional in there. And of course, we are really eager to move into animals. The first indication we plan to do by ourselves, and that is a hepatocellular carcinoma, where the immunological phenotype is very evident, and more recently it has been shown that M2 macrophages are playing a very crucial role, and they also predict even the outcome of the patients. It happens, again, we want like to come to UK, because we have a key collaborator in Birmingham, Professor David Adams, who is head of the liver center there, and they have also Medical Research Council supported early clinical phase unit, and they know precisely what kind of a clinical trial plan can be done and can be accepted by MRHA here in the UK. It will be called an adaptive design where we actually can adapt the results from the early dosing into a further development in that one. This is not a very small indication. 500,000 new cases every year, and at least half of them are M2 macrophage positive or clever ones, so that's the target group. We can also pre-select these patients. That is based on the fact that when the cancer is attracting these cells to go into the tumor, they have to be built from the bone marrow, a way all the way to the tumor, and we can actually see them in the circulation. Not only in the cancer patients, but also in the pregnant women. So it's a very interesting system which is operating in here. So since the IPO, I can just summarize that we have done pretty much what we promised and also with less money than we promised, which normally should be a rather good thing. The only thing which is still open is this orphan status. We haven't been able to convince the FDA that the number is below 200,000 in US, which is the statutory limit. But we are collecting additional documents really to support that and hopefully get it. So now moving with the interest trial in Europe, which is very exciting. And now also hope to get that we get the clinical development plan done for the MHR and get the advice and move on once the material is available. So interesting opportunity, not only a single project, but quite a number one, and possibility to expand those also to other indications and to other continents. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Markku. Thank you very much. Do we have any questions for Markku? The front.
In terms of your presence in the marketplace, where would you say your potential could be, and where are you at the moment?
Right. Well, all the CEOs think that the market price is, of course, way, way low, but that's not the issue. We came to the aim to raise capital in order to complete the interest trial. That's the main goal. If the product will be the very first product to the ARDS, there are no other even close at the moment. So we actually could take over that part totally. The analysts who are writing on us are saying that the potential of that could be up to 1 billion. And that's their opinion. It's really based on the kind of a pricing estimate and then the number of the patients.
But in terms of your market presence, where would you say you're in the league table? Are you at somewhere in the middle, at the bottom, or?
We may be on the low end at the moment, but hope to be at the high end in a year or so.
Question at the front.
In the interest study of Traumakine, I'm sort of wondering, how do you control for the possible sort of variation in the causative agent for the ARDS? And also in, I suppose, in the different totally different standards of care, because presumably your drug is given on top of standards of care in the different geographies where the study is being carried out.
Right. That's absolutely really important aspect that you try to harmonize your patient population as much as we can. What we have done a very unique protocol that actually contains even X-ray examples for all the sites so that they can verify. And we have one medical doctor which we hired from Manchester. Peter Nightingale had just retired from Manchester ICU, and he approves all the patients who are coming into the trial. So we really tried to kind of get rid of what they call Mickey Mouse cases so that there wouldn't be any foolings with the patients. So that's one thing. Secondary, the ICU treatments have been harmonized rather well. We wanted to stay in the western part of Europe in order to have that guaranteed, so we didn't go to Eastern European countries at this stage. The key thing is really the ventilation cycles and the fluid management, and that's mainly driven by the instrumentation of what the ICUs have. So I have a rather confident feeling that we will have a rather good population of the patients. So we should definitely see the difference between the placebo and the treatment.
Right. And are there differences between the US and the standards of care?
No, it's globally harmonized. Our independent data monitoring committee has members from US and Canada. And they have, of course, read the protocol and approve it, and they have said that it would be pretty much the same when you go to US.
A question at the back.
For Traumakine, could you tell me what the route of administration is?
It's IV. It's the only route of administration you can give to these patients. They are sedated and lying down. The peripheral circulation is so weak that you wouldn't get any. If you would use subcutaneous, it would depot under the skin. No effect whatsoever.
I was wondering if you could use nebulized.
Then you have to go through the lungs, which are filled with the water and everything. So not it wouldn't work. And our target is on the surface of the capillary, so inside. So you have to really go IV, and you have to get the boost immediately to the lungs. So I think the IV is the only route of the administration.
And the doses, how many mix per kg?
I couldn't hear.
Sorry, what's the actual dose you're giving to the
patient? Oh, it's a 10 microgram per day for 6 days, starting as early as possible. We now have a 48-hour window to get the consent, and that's the biggest challenge for the clinical sites. We hope that when we have a real treatment licensed once, I hope that the drug goes in during the first 12 hours or so. Earlier in, better result you have.